So I just want to, I was first inspired to do a little research on this topic because of my parents' divorce a few years ago, and started doing a little research in relation to how the Constitution applies to no fault, and reading different cases and coming to some interesting conclusions that I think are worth thinking about. So the first thing is to realize or recognize that marriage is a creature of nature, God-given, God-ordained. Divorce is a creature of the state. And so that's a very important understanding before we get into this and try to analyze and see how the state derives its authority to even grant divorces in the first place, and what limitations are placed on the legislature to create certain laws regarding divorce. So the first thing is, this is an illustration that basically demonstrates kind of the breakdown of marriage and the family from what we once understood as Christ-centered to now man-centered. And there's a clear transition from what we understood as a social institution to now what has become an independent or individual institution. And we can see that actually in the gay marriage case in 2015, where it's really the individual's expression rather than the for the greater good. So our constitutional system and Supreme Court precedent has defined marriage as and divorce law in the context of public policy. And what that necessarily requires is that there's a legal infraction to be able to dissolve a marriage in the first place. And there has to be an equal standard across the board that everyone must adhere to. In other words, a social harm that everyone can basically agree to. And so this has deteriorated to what would be kind of placed under the category of contract law. And I distinguish between private contract and public contract because public policy is basically public, would be a public contract. But this basically deconstructs the family and marriage to the consensual agreement of two parties. Not the greatest, but not the worst. It just basically eliminates the consideration of third parties, such as children and the greater society, but at least there are two parties that can make that determination. Today we have unilateral no-fault divorce, which is a completely, entirely different beast that we have to make sure that we nuance and understand in that context. And from what I can tell, there's 48 states that have this. The other two have mutual no-fault still, but we need to understand that this is a pervasive problem in our country right now. I came across this very intriguing constitutional provision, first actually in the Maryland Constitution, that says the General Assembly or the legislature shall not pass special laws granting divorces. And I thought that was really peculiar because that's precisely what we're talking about. And so this is a limitation placed on the legislature to enact certain laws granting divorces. And I thought, well, I don't really understand what that means, but I'll do a little research into it. And so my parents' case was in New York, so I decided to see if there was anything, any mention of something similar in New York. And it was worded a little bit differently. It was, nor shall any divorce be granted otherwise than by due judicial proceedings. And I said, well, there must be some kind of connection between these two. And there are. There's a lot of implications that can be drawn. But basically, I mapped out all of the state constitutions are a little bit different and provide different protections than the general U.S. Constitution. But over 30 state constitutions have this provision regarding divorce. And a special law can basically be synonymous with the idea of private law or a subjective law, whereas a general law could be understood in, similarly to a public law or a objective law. And so really we were talking about subjective grounds for divorce and objective grounds for divorce, and that's really what it comes down to. So basically this constitutional provision is affirming that marriage is a based on public policy, it has a social context to it, and that we need to make laws that are objective standards that deter certain social ills or behaviors, but not that we can individualize each case and allow people to get divorced for any reason and for no reason at all. And so there are historical reasons for why this provision is in place. But I think this is one thing that needs to be investigated and looked at in terms of how this can be applied, because no fault, I mean, you add the pretext, or you add the prefix no to fault, and you basically go from law to no law, because, I mean, this is a completely different, people tend to think of no fault as a liberalization of divorce. I don't think it's a liberalization of divorce. I think it's the abolishment of marriage as a legal institution. I think we need to look at it that way. So I've categorized no-fault statutes basically down to two different approaches. One is a statute that basically compels certain or precisely prescribes certain legally imposed conditions. One example being compelled speech, but it could be anything else that basically compels someone, a party, to say or do something as justification for divorce. And basically it's a hard and fast rule. And so by the time it gets to the judge, or if you invoke that statute, the judge is not looking at the individual facts of your case, even though they may appear to or present themselves in that way. But they're really just taking a look at, did you fulfill this bureaucratic requirement? And if you have, then I am legally compelled to grant the divorce. And what that ends up, what ends up happening is that a judge is not acting within a realm of discretion, saying, okay, here's the legal bounds, and have you fulfilled these requirements? Legal obligations have to do with the relationship between one party and another. But legally imposed conditions are basically self-imposed conditions whereby one spouse can fulfill the requirements of the law and not have anything, any relation to the other party, which is changes the functions of what the judges are doing. The other category is the government basically endorsing the beliefs and opinions of one spouse. And so if the whole idea of irretrievable breakdown or a marriage that is insupportable has to do with the state of the marriage or the quality of the marriage, essentially the government will take the side of the spouse who believes that the marriage is irretrievable. Now, of course, that's a subjective belief or opinion, but it's one that the government actually endorses, as opposed to the spouse who believes that it's not irretrievable or broken down. So these are the two kind of statutes that you can kind of evaluate any of the laws that are in the various states. They'll be worded a little bit differently to confuse the people, but basically you can narrow it down to one of these two things. So let me just give a quick example. So in New York, the statute basically says that in order to invoke the no-fault statute and to obtain a divorce, one spouse has to swear that the marriage is irretrievably broken for a period of at least 6 months. So the question for the judge is not whether your marriage is irretrievable, it's whether the spouse has sworn that it's irretrievable. And that's a different question. That's something that demonstrates that the judge is not considering any of the facts or any of the legal rights that are established under the marriage. The judge is just looking to see if you've checked the box. And if you have, then all he has to do is check the box as well. Another example would be Minnesota. The statute just says irretrievable breakdown, but the Supreme Court of Minnesota, the highest court in the land, has basically interpreted the statute to mean that all that is required is the showing of evidence that one party's belief demonstrates that the marriage is irretrievably broken. So again, it's kind of a contradiction of terms, because you're saying there needs to be evidence, but what's the evidence? It's not that the marriage is irretrievable, it's whether one spouse believes that it is. So I think that understanding really is important if we're going to move forward in terms of legal arguments or legal reforms, to really understand what the court is evaluating or taking a look at. So from what I've gathered, I think the problem comes down to a problem of separation of powers, a judge not acting in a judicial capacity, and what that actually means. So this is actually taken from a Supreme Court case in South Carolina, which I think expresses what a judicial act is and what it requires, the elements of what the judicial function means. And so if divorce is a public act, and that's what we've really converted. We've converted divorce into private proceedings, and viewed it as the relationship between just two people rather than the community or the state at large. And so what judges are, what no-fault statutes are essentially doing is taking that, the relational aspect of the legal obligations between the two parties out of the equation completely. And so what's left is basically one spouse has the primary entitlement to divorce and as like a, as a privilege rather than as a right. So lastly, our system of government is set up to have, you know, three distinct branches of government, each with their own distinguished responsibilities: the legislature to make the laws, the judiciary to evaluate and interpret the laws, and the executive to carry out the laws. And so when you have a statute that essentially compels a party seeking divorce to do this and do that, or express your beliefs that the marriage is irretrievable, then the judge is essentially left without any ability, and several have admitted this, that we must grant the divorce. There's no wiggle room, there's no ability for us to deny the divorce. And and that really consolidates the judiciary with the executive, which is just signing off, rubber stamping the divorce decree, and consolidating that power into something that is predetermined, something that you really can't defend against. And that's what it comes down to, is not having the right of defense. And I think we need to be able to look at these laws and try to articulate that in a way that is irrefutable, to say that there is no defense to the no-fault grounds, and that the judiciary is basically granting divorces as a predetermined outcome.